Merry meet, my friends, from the hallowed halls of Kekromancy, where we take your memes from your dreams and make them real. Now, over the weekend, there was something of a fuss in regards to role-playing games, which is something that is very much within my wheelhouse. It's a little hard to explain that easily, so I'll just let them speak for themselves. And obviously, going into this, I don't want you to hassle any of these people or harass them. This is purely for informational purposes and for me to reply in my own way. Mr. James Intricasso wrote, "I love to see the RPG audience growing and getting more diverse. We all win when more people play. For those who are not cis, white, straight men like me, how can us cis, white, straight men help the audience for our hobby continue to become more welcoming and diverse?" Now, like many people, James doesn't really understand why statements such as this make certain people so very angry. And it's not really that difficult to understand when you think about it, and it doesn't reveal some deep abiding bigotry amongst them. I am a soft, wet liberal, as soft as they come, and I take exception to statements like this because I'm on the left. You see, James, you open up by apologizing for the fact that you identify as the same gender as the body that you're in. You start by apologizing for the color of your skin. You start by apologizing for the configuration of your genitals. And none of these things are things that anybody should be apologizing for, or that should matter one tit or tattle. Not at all should any of this matter. So when you self-flagellate in front of everyone, a lot of people necessarily roll their eyes. Further, you are implying by your statements that gaming was ever not open and welcoming. I mean, women, minorities, people like that have been involved in D&D and the broader role-playing hobby since its very inception. It's like you're ignoring history and rewriting, and this happens a great deal with people who consider themselves to be on the social justice-y end of the spectrum. They ignore the history of the hobby or the fandom or whatever else it is that they now finagle their way into. And further, it is the presence of people like this that is making the hobby less welcoming, that is not appreciating the diversity of ideas, which has now hilariously been labelled a dog whistle. I mean, one need only look to Marvel to see how tokenism and forced inclusion can be catastrophic for a company. And we would really rather see this nipped in the bud before it causes catastrophic damage to the role-playing industry as well, which in all things considered is doing quite well lately. So, with all that in mind, and that objections to these things is not bigotry or prejudice, and much of it comes from the idea that race, gender, sexuality, and so on should be irrelevant when it comes to the person, let's look at a few of the suggestions that he got. Matthew P. wrote, "As a person of colour, I find the idea of sapient people being restricted to one alignment, i.e. drow and orcs, really off-putting. It feels a lot like the setting is trying to justify racism as an okay thing for these species, so I seek out games without that trope." It's a fantasy. It's a game. In no way does this reflect anyone's real opinions about races. It's an old fantasy trope. It goes back, I guess, to C.S. Lewis and Tolkien, who were contemporaries. You know, orcs were irredeemably evil when it came to Tolkien's work. And yeah, I'm an atheist, so if this was a suggestion for the real world, that there existed some genuine and absolute metaphysical, irredeemable evil, rather than it being points of view, yeah, that would annoy me. If we were playing a modern game and it said something like, well, I can't even say it or my video will be demonetized, but you know, unless you're playing Rahoa, you're not going to run into any actual racism, and these are species. You know, it is in the nature of a species to have certain behaviors. If tigers were sapient, we might find some of the things that they did evil from our point of view. But this is all beside the point. Within the context of these game worlds, where metaphysics are real, where good and evil are real things, forces, natures, powers within the world that you are playing in, it makes sense to have this. And it does avoid the whole moral questions around slaughtering so many monsters in certain games. And that's fine. My objections to this kind of thinking in the real world have no bearing upon how I play within the game. And furthermore, these things have interesting implications when it comes to game worlds. When there is a true, absolute, and defined metaphysical good and evil, it can be interesting to insert oneself into the shoes of people who believe that, to think how it would influence and impact upon society. Would it mean that these different groups couldn't at all live in peace with each other? It's interesting, and part of role-playing is to step into a world that is something different, to explore and experiment with different mindsets, and you seem to think that should all be one way. Might it not be useful to you to understand why people who hold these kind of viewpoints might hold these kinds of viewpoints, and why and how those viewpoints might be propagated? Or you could just play the game for fun. Misty wrote, "Making it safe for people to be in the community in the first place. Safety tools are a good first step, along with visible representation. Also, lift up the voices that are not cishet white men. Most importantly, listen. For Morticia's sake, listen." Well, there's a lot to unpack there. The cis phobia, the heterophobia, the racism towards white people, the sexism towards men, the idea that somehow just because you have a protected identity, you must be lifted up, rather than being treated equally to everyone else. You know, that really grips my shit when people say things like that, because I do not like racism, I do not like sexism, I do not like prejudice against people because of their sexuality or their identity. And yet I see people who claim to be against these things so very often being avatars, elementals thrust into our plane from the elemental plane of hypocrisy. And it's fucking annoying. You're everything you claim to hate, and it happens over and over again. So there's that, the hypocrisy and the hatred, which isn't going to make people likely to be particularly welcoming towards you. Safety. In what way are you unsafe? Exactly. You're sat at a table, rolling dice and talking to people. If someone genuinely physically threatens you or touches you, this is obvious. But that's not what you're talking about, is it? No, this is things like X cards. This is things like anti-harassment policies that wildly overreach beyond the issue of harassment, which is really a matter for the law, and end up censoring people at conventions or in stores. I mean, a lot of the time now, people aren't even meeting in person to play games. They're playing online. So if you feel unsafe, click, and it's all gone. So this is all stuff that sounds nice, but when you start thinking about it, when you start experiencing it, when you start seeing what people are actually asking for, it rapidly becomes obvious that this is a grotesquely overblown and monstrous sense of entitlement. And demands made upon games, upon groups, to accommodate your every whim. See, it's not listening that you want, because we may listen and disagree with you, or find your arguments wanting or your evidence lacking, and we may therefore dismiss what you say. So it's not listening you want. You want us to listen and then immediately and unquestioningly implement everything that you want, regardless of the detriment to the game, to the product, to the hobby, to the convention, to the store. That's not something I think you can reasonably ask for. There's a ton more of these, but irony gives me a boner, so I'm going to go with this one. David Bowman says, "Mostly I try to call out people for not being inclusive. Gatekeepers need to step back. I also try to curb behaviour of my own that I know bothers people, such as explaining their character abilities. I've gotten so good at letting people play their own game and not helping." I think that answer encapsulates a lot of the problems with this attitude and the way that it has been done. He's talking about not gatekeeping, while at the same time, gatekeeping. If you're not inclusive enough, he will call you out, and God knows what the standards of inclusivity are. In some ways, this is the paradox of tolerance. To what extent should we be tolerant of intolerance? But I just know that this is going to include people who misstep over certain things, or get a pronoun wrong occasionally, or try to help someone who doesn't want the help. And doesn't that just say it all? That this atmosphere of opprobrium has made it so that people are afraid to help. Something that made gaming so inclusive and good and welcoming was that people were always ready to help. Sure, I can understand that that might be annoying if people are assuming you're new just because you have breasts or your skin is of a darker hue or whatever else. But it comes from a good place. You know, people are eager to make you feel wanted, to help you make the best out of your character, to get the most from the game, and you're rebuffing that to the point where decent people now feel afraid to offer to help, and will even shout down other people for God knows what reasons. That's not going to make your table more welcoming in any way. So like I said, there were a lot more, but I would be here until next week if I went through and answered every single one. So I'm going to try and sum up what I've seen here. There seems to be this huge sense of entitlement that anyone and everyone else, the majority around the table, must bend every way possible to meet whatever whimsical demand that someone who is a member of a protected class asks of them. When you enter into a game, this is part of a social contract. You're a microcosm of society, if you will. There must be give and take on all sides in order for everyone to have a good amount of fun. That doesn't mean you can have your way in every single instance. And a big string of similarities between comments that I saw here were basically a reframing of what we used to call the ninja problem. There's a certain kind of problematic player who, no matter what game you're playing, will always choose to play a ninja. It can be anything else, it's just ninja was the stereotypical one that made it. So, you know, if you're playing Cyberpunk, they'll play a corporate ninja, you know, industrial espionage agent. Which is fair enough. And in certain other games, you know, the ninja character type, the stealthy assassin, whatever, fits fine. Other games, it doesn't. And maybe you want a different atmosphere. Maybe you want that player to stretch their legs and play something different for once. But if they keep insisting on doing it, it becomes disruptive to the whole game for everyone else. And this is equally true if you come at a game and you insist that you must represent your own highly granulated identity regardless of the world. You know, if you're playing a historical game set during the Inquisition, for example, and you choose to play an openly, flagrantly non-binary, gender, whatever, you shouldn't be surprised when your character ends up tied to a stake and burned by priests. You know, that the world in which you're trying to insert that character cannot stay credible, cannot stay plausible, cannot stay accurate to the very point of history that it's trying to make without dicking you over for playing that character, if the GM even allows you to. And it's not an expression of bigotry or prejudice to do so. Indeed, it can be an opportunity to learn and to think about how these things operate. You know, in a game, if a fertility cult is hostile to your character because your character is gay, that makes sense. So when you make these decisions, you know, it has impact. And if it doesn't have impact, then the immersion, the suspension of disbelief evaporates like mist. It's gone. So often you're being unreasonable. In other settings, modern settings, future settings and so on, then these things can perhaps be more accommodated. But sometimes the games master is going for a particular mood, or the group as a whole, apart from you, is going for a particular theme somehow, wants to tell a particular kind of story. And when it comes to that, when you make these kind of demands, you're just being a dick. The same as the guy who just always wants to play a ninja. And you have to understand that there has to be that give and take, and often you're going to be outnumbered at the table. And you know, you can play something different to yourself. You don't have to be represented. It's an opportunity to put yourself in someone else's shoes, to experience life and hardship and challenge through a different set of abilities and perceptions. And that's valuable. That increases empathy. And if you don't do that, and if you demand that everyone bow down to everything that you want, you're going to make people more hostile. You're going to make games less welcoming. And the only diversity that people don't seem to want is diversity of ideas and stories. And that's supposedly what we're all here for. Plus escapism. I think you also have to recognize that a lot of people come to games to escape from all this political and social bullshit that they find around themselves. And games also provide that opportunity for you to escape. So when you bring your politics, when you bring your identity nonsense into a game, you're often stealing something, compromising something, wrecking something very precious to people. And that is an opportunity to set all that aside and to just have fun.
I want the whole world. I want to lock it all.